So, hello, good morning. Today we're going to do a screencast again. This is partly also me trying to decide between the A7R 3 and the A7R 4. I kind of already made this decision, but I want to show how I got here. And or choosing between or adding would be more in my case. I will add it to my collection. But I see a lot of people sort of talking about the quality difference in noise between the A7R 3 and the A7R 4. Now, my point is not to go really deeply into this discussion. Everybody, I think it's always best that everybody decides for themselves. My gut feeling is, and I will show you why I think this, is partly based on the fact that you have more megapixels and that you're zooming in and you are not doing a fair comparison, if that makes sense. I will try to make some comments when we get into it more, but I think that's probably where it ends up at. Also, let me remind people that sensor development is not magic. The improvements are small and wide apart. I think we are probably at the edge of a new generation of sensors, which I personally hope was already getting into the next generation Sonys. It didn't. So we are still with, I wouldn't say old sensor tech, but let's say stable sensor tech and not new sensor tech. And so we might have to wait one more step until we see real massive steps in that area. So what I suggest everybody to do with all my videos is to go around the web, YouTube, and read blogs and watch reviews and try to figure stuff out for yourself. Sorry for the somewhat long introduction, but I think that's much better than I heard somebody say, or I've been listening to reviews and people say that the noise is worse and totally unacceptable above 400 ISO or something like that. So what I suggest for most people, what I do, is use something like a comparison tool. So the one that I really like is the one from DP Review. So if you search for DP Review ISO comparison tool, you will automatically find it. Well, not automatically, but it should be quite easy to find. And then it opens up with this view. I will go to full screen to make it a little bit easy, and I will explain a little bit what we are seeing. And I'm basically redoing what I've done myself to figure out, is there any truth to this, and what would it entail? Now, I also try to make some remarks what I think about this tool. I wouldn't say it's all good, but you have to know where the edges are. This is not, for example, to make sure to test which lens or which camera is sharper, because they sometimes put different lenses on there. But it is a way to compare the noise levels between lenses and cameras. Sorry, between cameras. So you start with this empty view and you have to select your camera. So what we will do is we will compare the cameras we want to compare. So in this case, the A7R 4, which is the one that we want to see. The A7R 3, which is the one we are directly comparing it to. For reference, we'll put in the A7 3, because by many that's now considered the best in the range. They exclude the S2. It's still early Sunday morning, so A7 3, there it is. And for total comparison, I will also put a medium format one in here. And let's go for the Fuji GFX 100. Now, there's a few things that before we get started that you notice. The first thing is default, it starts in JPEG, so I will put it in RAW, because otherwise it tells you it shows you what the camera maker built in to sort of combat things like noise levels and ISO parts. Now, you can see in this area the part that we are basically sort of zooming into, so we're always zooming into one-to-one. So let's go to the edge of this part, just an example. Now, the first thing that you notice is that the sizes are not all the same, right? You can see that clearly on some of these pictures, so this is 42 megapixels, this is 61 megapixels, this is 24 megapixels, and this is 100 megapixels, And you can get all this information if you click or press on this one, right? Although this doesn't tell us that how big it is, but you can see the JPEG file or the RAW file is much bigger. So this one is 61 megapixels, right? But you also see that they are not using the same lens. So for in this case, they are using the 1.4GM lens, 85. While this one, they are using the normal 85. So it's not a direct comparison. So that's not what we are looking for. The second thing I want to point out is that the difference in size actually needs to be compensated if you want to compare for noise. Just to make a point, I will put this one into pixel shift mode. So basically, this will now give the A7R3 a 240 megapixel sensor field. And you can clearly see now, again, don't look at the sharpness in some cases, depends on what it is. But you can see that now clearly this one is much bigger than the others and even bigger than the medium format camera, right? So because the sharpness is a little bit weird or tricky, because if you go to this area, for example, then you can see, I guess you can also see the quality of, in this case, the Fuji lens. But you're never sure what they have done to make this kind of work. So let's put it back on this one. So one important button is basically this one, which is the comparison button. Then it will scale back the image to make it a fair comparison by downsampling it to the correct number of pixels or to the comparable number of pixels. Because if you are talking about noise level, it makes perfect sense if you go into the 61 megapixel sensor size. So let's reverse it around. So let's say you have a 35 millimeter sensor, which is these three all have the same sensor. There's the same amount of light falling into the sensor, and the sensor has to convert that into digital data. All three of them get the same amount of light, and all three of them have to turn this into a picture. So the fact that this one, the 60 megapixel one, 61 megapixel one, has smaller pixels compared to the 24 one, the bottom one, it makes perfect sense that if you zoom in further, it would actually show you more noise, right? So this has been explained online, and does not, let me put this on normal, which is a little bit more fair. But that makes perfect sense. But now if you compensate them, then it's a much more fair comparison, right? Because you're not taking an image into a 1.1, but you're just taking an image and maybe cropping it into a certain level. And we'll get back to that. So first, let's do some realistic comparison in this setting. So we didn't turn off the lights, because here you can turn on the lights on and off, which can also be helpful. And my suggestion is not to prove anything in this video. My suggestion is use this tool to walk around yourself, try settings, try cameras that you have owned before, and see what you think yourself. But I will point out a few interesting points. So let's go to RAW, and let's first go to 1600, right? So we are now going to compare the noise levels at 1600 compensated, right? So you see that the size is about the same, even on the medium format. And now clearly the medium format is cleaner, right? There's no doubt there. That's the cleanest of the four, which makes perfect sense, because Fuji is also using the same generation Sony sensor. So that makes sense. There's more light coming into the camera and or onto the sensor, and makes sense that it is has less noise. Again, just to prove a point, if we take this into, which we can't do, I will do that later because we have to be at 6400. But you can see that if we turn this into a really a pixel for pixel mode, so we let basically the 61 megapixel talk for itself, you can see that indeed the noise level becomes bigger, right? But in my opinion, that's not a fair comparison. And so this is the one that you should compare. Now, do you feel that this has more noise than this, or this has more than this, I tend to suggest that the A7 R4 has a little bit more noise, but mostly into the color area, if that makes sense. And I think what we are seeing, and if we go to a different place of this, you can see this. it is not that far off, right? So if we look at the three Sonys, I would argue that it's not like a massive difference. But I do think there's a difference, and I think it has to do with color accuracy. So if you go into the higher ISO ranges, right? So let's go to this one and then go to 6400. You can see that on 6400, when we scale it back, that the noise levels on the between the A7R 3 and the A7R 4, I wouldn't say that they are the same, because I think people have a point that on the A7R 3, it's less than on the A7R 4. But I also think it has to do with color accuracy and let's say the differences between the noise pixels, if that makes sense. It seems to be that these are more uniform. And if you compare it to older cameras, I remember clearly between the previous generation and this generation, not that the noise became less, but the noise became less color variation. So maybe that's one thing that they tuned on. So now it's kind of interesting to go to JPEG just to see how they internally will process it and see what of a difference we see then, right? So again, you have to make up your own mind which do you think is better or worse once we compensate for it, right? And again, we are already at 6400 ISO. Now, of course, one of the major arguments that you can make is that you can, on the more megapixels, you can trade the noise levels for detail, right? So if you go to full view again, you can clearly see that the two higher megapixel ones have more detail to be recovered. Now, of course, the recovery works better if you go to ISO 100, right? Because then you can clearly see, you see much more details on the higher pixel ones. I hope this makes sense. Even if you go to the raw ones, you can see, well, pretty clean, but this one clearly more detail. If you go to this part of the picture, let's go to a text. Now it becomes very obvious, right, that this one, the 24 megapixels, can't compete with the 42 megapixels, the 61 megapixels, and the 100 megapixels. Keep in mind that these are not all the same lenses, making the comparison on the sharpness level a little bit more difficult, right? So, if we go up to the ISO range, so let's say 1600, simply because of the noise getting more influence over the detail levels, you'll see that this gap becomes smaller, but you can still see clearly at 1600 that it's cleaner. Again, do this yourself and you can see that it's cleaner, strong word, sharper, right? So there's more detail to be recovered, so you can make a trade-off between sharpness and noise levels yourself when you're doing the processing, right? So once it's processed, you can argue, and especially if you put it in direct comparison, well, is it this one then far off from this one? No. So on 6400, you could make the argument that most likely you don't see much difference between the A7R3 and the A7R4. So there is some argument to be made that once you did the processing, that on the, let's say, 6400 and up levels, you don't see much of a difference between the two. And that's probably, good or bad, it's up to you, right? Because here you see a little bit more noise, but again, my argument would be that it is more color variation than really noise levels, because once you process it, and even if you use the Sony or internal one, you can see that I would argue, again, we are looking way, way zoomed in, right? So here again, the total image, here is the part that we are zooming into, right? And if once we take advantage of all the pixels, you can see that there's much more detail to be regained here, especially on lower ISO. So let's go to 800. You can see 24, 61. Now, one interesting thing I wanted to, and of course, so that is my point, right? Compare it yourself, see what the noise levels are, and do that. So let's turn off the lights, which you can do here, and go to a darker piece of the picture. So let's go to this one. Again, let's go to 100 ISO, because I want to slowly also show something else. So let's go to this part. So one interesting thing that you are seeing is moiré, right? It really depends a little bit on the sensor. So you can see that this one has an AA filter, so it takes away the moiré much better. But you can see on the A7R3 and the A7R4, we see clearly moiré over here. And because of the little bit of luck and also the more megapixels, you can see that there's almost no moiré in this part of this picture here, right? So, but again, you can see the noise levels. Let's go to, we get back to this part, but let's go to the edge. And go to, for example, again, 6400. You can now see that this is, of course, the cleanest again, and because it's a bigger sensor, way bigger sensor. And you can see here the three, so the A7III, the A7R3, and the A7R4. Again, I don't have any deep opinions, but keep in mind, we are doing a full comparison. So once we scale them back, takes a while. Sometimes it does not really want to reload the correct images, so let me switch it just to make sure. So you can see that also this one is a little bit darker. I think that's just the way that so that the new ones become a little bit more lighter. But on 6400 ISO, you can clearly see that there isn't a massive difference between the 42 megapixels and the 6400 megapixels. I'm not sure how much of this will make it to YouTube once it's there. But I wanted to show you one more thing, because I think that's kind of interesting, on the moiré effect, right? So let's go back to this part where you clearly can see the different moiré in the different pictures. So this is clean, but mushy. This is not clean. This is not clean in the moiré effect. One of the nice things, and I think it was on 1600. Let me find it back. Oh, you have to turn on the light. Pity they didn't do the megapixel ones on all of them. So we're turning on light again and going to 1600. And then, or 6400. I think they only made two. They made one 100 ISO and one on 6400 ISO, where I can also go into this pixel shift mode of doing, they did 240 megapixels, so they did four shots, and then also four shifted shots, so 60 shots total. And you can see what that can do. And I think that's also quite interesting. Why? Because it's also using a trick combining multiple exposures to reduce noise, which is something that you can also do in post-processing. So I'm not saying that this is a solution, but if you want, you can either use a very good noise reduction algorithm, but you can also decide to take multiple pictures of a wildlife scene, where you take multiple pictures and you let the background, which you are, that if you're on a tripod not moving, which is not moving, let the areas combine to reduce the noise. So take four pictures and combine them. And just to showcase I will show it in this case. So there's two effects that should go away once we go into this pixel mode. The first is the moiré, because four of the shots will automatically overlap all the colors, and so this should go away. The second thing which should happen is, because it's combining 16 pictures into one picture, is that you get 16 exposures. So that means that the time that the sensor has been able to gather data will also be much bigger. So the noise levels should go down. So let's put it in this pixel shift mode. I'm actually not sure if they also did on this one, no, which is a pity. But you can see what I was trying to say. You can see that now clearly, if you compare, we are still in comparison view, right? So clearly you can see that the moiré has gone from the A7R4. It's still available in the A7R3 because they didn't provide us the option here. And you can see that it's already sharper than the A7 III. Again, that depends a little bit on the lens. But now the interesting one, if we turn this into the full view, because now you can see, I think that's quite interesting, even the difference. Now the lenses will affect definitely here, because Fuji is way sharp in this part of the image. But you can see that the amount of detail, theoretically, that you can pull from A7 R4 in this multi-shot version is, I would argue, far from bad. And I've checked some other parts of the image. Again, we are at 64 ISO, right? You can see there's massive amounts of detail. And the noise level, because we are now combining four, you can see that it has definitely effect. Because if we go into this normal one, you will see that the noise level goes up, right? If I go into this pixel shift mode, it combining them, which I think is interesting. I think in their pixel shift picture, it's not a perfect one, right? So again, don't look too much at the sharpness, but look at the noise levels. So if you go to, not the JPEG one, but 100. They only did it in RAW. So there we have the pixel shift mode. You can see how much more detail is to be had, right? So compared to this one, to this one. Again, I'm not sure if it was totally sharp, but that's another discussion. But you can see if you put it in JPEG mode, then it doesn't do this comparison anymore. But now if you scale it back, again, I'm just sort of fiddling around, and I think everybody should do that. Just sort of go into different parts of this image and wander around, play with the different settings of cameras that you have owned or want to own, and compare it yourself, right? That would be my main argument. So if you say 6400 is the upper limit I want to shoot, compare these cameras in comparison mode like this, or in print mode, you can also do that. But I would say this one and this one is the most useful, because this one tells you how much detail you can pull from it, and this one tells you how it compares to the other cameras, right? So on 6400, just walk around in the different places of the picture, turn on the lights, turn off the lights, right? And make up your own mind how you think these two cameras compare. So most likely I will get a lot of remarks again on this video, but I wanted to get to the point that people compare themselves and they just don't sort of go out and ask. And I've seen online that the A7 R3 has more noise or less noise, or the A7 R4 is blah blah blah, or the A7 III is way cleaner than, because you have to take into account, let's say, how the camera has been set up with the amount of megapixels, with the noise reductions that they are applying internally on JPEG, with the color noise levels, if that makes sense, which you can all, I wouldn't say fix, but compensate for in post-processing, right? So clearly, for example, if we let the camera do it itself, and you compare the A7 III, the A7 R3, and the A7 R4, I personally think that they are not that far off, right? So that should not be a reason for you not to go with the A7 R4, because there's of course a lot of advantages to it, and one of them is resolution. So let's go to this area and before we stop. Again, I left the JPEG engine on, and let's go to a city, so 2500,000, right? And again, you can compare the A7 R3 with the A7 R4, different lenses, so it's not a totally fair comparison. But you can see it's also not, like, in my view, not that far off. And keep in mind, you are now at a silly high ISO levels. And you also zoomed in up to a level which I would argue is not normal to be able to zoom in, right? So that's what I wanted to convince myself of, but I also want to share it to you how to use this tool or how to compare it yourself and look at the differences yourself. You can see how clean this Fuji is, by the way. It's a very impressive camera. It's a pity that it's not more useful in that way. But you can also see if you go back to 100 megapixels. Sorry, if you go back to ISO 100, then you could argue again there's difference with the lenses. But in this case, is there really that much to gain from going to an GFX 100 compared to an A7 R4? I think it's holding up quite nicely, right? And if you even go into full view, not saying, again, you have to keep in mind the lenses. Let's turn the lights on. Is there really that much of a difference when we are pixel peeping already? And I can tell you that, well, in this part, there is a difference. So again, make up your own mind. But I would argue that the A7 R4 is probably a very good sort of compromise camera. And oh, there's one thing I want to show you. Sorry if you're still here. One thing which I think is a very interesting comparison is to compare it not with the A7 R3, but to compare it with an A6500. Or let's do the A6400, because that's a newer generation. Right? Put it in RAW again and put it in comparison. Why am I doing this? Because let's also turn the lights back on and go to, let's go to this part of the picture again. So one thing which I think is a big value of the A7 R3 and the A7 R4 is to use it as a crop camera. And what I mean with this is that I like the fact that the A7 R4 and also the A7 R2, but the A7 R4 even more because it has a way better tracking system and it also has more megapixels in crop mode. How does that compare to what Sony's best APS-C cameras are at the moment? Why? Because I think if you want to take one camera with you, that's actually a very valid sort of argument. Because you can kind of put it in sort of shooting mode for birds or for wildlife or for air show photography. You still have this massive sort of range because you're in crop mode, but you're still having one camera body and it can do basically switch from one to the other. If you put it in crop mode, you also get a way deeper buffer, you get phase detect over your whole sensor, stuff like that, right? So I think that's a very valuable thing. But so it's interesting to compare the cameras basically to a crop sensor. Now the results should be kind of the same, because if we look at the generation, so this is the A7 R4 and the A6400, they kind of both have a new sensor, so the sensor generation is about the same. So I would suspect that the noise levels will be about the same. But of course, the A7 R4 actually has more megapixels in crop than the A6400. So let's see what happens here, right? And now we see something, in my opinion, again, we are in comparison view, right? So this is kind of an interesting result. If I'm wrong, please somebody correct me. But if I go into one pixels, right, and compare them, right? So compare them because I put this in comparison view. So that means that if we are using a crop, so let's say this is the full frame. Well, because it is a full frame, and this would be the crop sort of area, right? 1.5 times less. Then basically the rest of the picture is the same. So if we put this in comparison mode, this is a kind of a fair comparison between these two cameras, right? And now actually, because we are not using the full frame anymore as a full frame, but we are seeing two things. A, how do they compare in noise level? Well, I would argue that the A7 R4 is actually a bit cleaner than the A6400. Maybe this is just me, but that's what my gut feeling tells me here. Not sure what lens they put on this one. They put a very sharp lens on this one, by the way. So the 55 lens on this one, it was still, well, it's also a GM lens. So these are both two very sharp lenses, right? So depending if they focused correctly, so you can see that the sharpness is there. But what you can also see is that the noise levels are actually pretty close, or I would argue better on the A7 R4. Let's go into the silly level, right? So why is that important, at least for me? Again, I'm partly also looking for myself in this case, is that if you use an A7 R4 in crop mode, what will the end result be, right? So if you go to a normal one, let's say you're shooting, which happens if you are using a fast subject and you're doing air shows, you might end up at 3200 or 6400 just to get the speed that you want, right? So let's look at 3200, and you can see what the noise levels would be, again, pixel peeping into your crop area, right? And I think personally, this is pretty darn impressive. You have a little bit more resolution on the A7 R4 in crop mode, because this is 27 megapixels in crop mode. This is 24 megapixels in crop mode. This one is clearly sharper than this one. Not sure if it tells you something about the lens. And again, if you let the camera internally do some processing, which is not as good if you do it yourself, but it gives you some idea what happens after you process them, you can see what happens at 3200, right? So let's go to this part. And I think, wow, this is, again, I would not fully trust the lens setup here, but I'm wondering if I'm making a mistake. No, I'm not making a mistake. So again, draw your own conclusions, and sharpness is always tricky to look at. But you can trade it off for more depth, right? So even if in this case we are now saying, no, compare them full view again, you can see the difference, how far we can actually crop in. I hope this makes sense. Although for this is a much more fair comparison. So if you go to, let's say, 6400, which would be the highest that I would probably want to shoot if you're doing things like bird photography and you are forced into this higher ISOs, what would happen then if you go into, if you compare these two cameras, right? I think it's pretty close to the A6400, which kind of makes sense if you think about a generational difference between this sensor and this sensor. And also the A7 R3 is a bit better, which is also amazing in itself. I wouldn't say better, it's different, right? So it looks to me that on the newer cameras, they kind of pull back a little bit in the color noise algorithm. So it seems to me that the noise is just nicer. I think that's the best way to say it, on the older generation of sensors, or at least the algorithm that they've used. Maybe they are thinking that it can be handled in post-processing better. And if you put it in JPEG mode, you kind of see that indeed sort of pan out, and that they figured that that was a better balance because of the higher ISOs. What I've heard is the R4 keeps its colors a bit better than the older generations is doing. So maybe that's one of the things that they tuned and why they did it. So I've been rambling for a long time. So see you in the next one. This is basically me on a Sunday morning trying to fiddle around with this tool, which I think everybody should do if they are really want to check out some of the noise levels and what the differences are. Just for the fun, last one, let's put this back into an iPhone X. So just to give you an idea of what happens, right? And again, why people make the argument that you can take nice pictures with an iPhone in the daytime. And if we keep it in comparison mode, you can totally see why this argument is made, right? But once we go in the higher ISOs, which I'm not sure how far, we have to be in RAW. This one can't be in RAW, so it's only in JPEG. So we can't change it. But if we go turn off the lights, that's probably a good way to force the whole thing. And we go into a darker area. It should not survive. Let's see if it does that. Again, this one is now at a silly high. Oh, we're going to go to 640. Okay. So there it goes into 640. Let's also put this in JPEG. And put this one also in 640. No, we can't. So put it in 800. But you can see now the difference. And that's what you're seeing when you're using, I would say, in a real camera compared to an iPhone, even iPhone 10. You can see that it loses detail on a massive scale once you get into this higher ISO situations. And even if, of course, now if you put it in full comparison, you can also see the difference in what an A7 R4 can do, let's say at 1600 ISO, which is quite high, compared to what an iPhone can do if you take a picture at night of your friends in a restaurant and you did some processing, right? You can see that there is a massive difference. But again, if you go back into, I just want to take a nice picture in the daytime, so let's turn on the lights again and put it at ISO 100. And then you can see there's still a difference because we got it full, but let's say we do it like this. Why people say that you can take some really damn nice pictures with your iPhone. Anyway, this is always a fun tool to play around with. As you clearly notice, I've been doing it for the last probably half an hour. So, thank you for watching. My main point, even if you have watched only a few minutes, go do this tool yourself. Try to figure it out for yourself. Look at the noise levels especially. Fill around with the different cameras that you have owned or want to own and compare them without sort of any prejudice. And try to figure it out for yourself what makes sense and what you can do if you compare it pixel to pixel, if you compare it image to image, and if you compare it on different crop levels that you think you will be using. So thank you for watching and see you in the next one. Bye bye.